Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, I am speaking with Richard Van Camp. Richard is a member of the Klecho Dene Nation from Fort Smith, Northwest Territories. He's with us today. He is a prolific writer. He's written 26 books in 26 years. Holy cow. And in just about every medium possible, short stories, novels, children book, comics, you name it. Richard, I am so happy to be chatting with you.
Thank you, Tamara. It's a pleasure. Masicho. Thanks for having me.
No, it's a real thrill because you have this new book, Gather, Richard Van Camp, on the joy of storytelling. And I love this book because I've always said, like, when I worked in news, I always said, you know, it's our job to tell stories, right? And if we tell the stories, we can bring people in, and that's how we connect. We connect through our stories and our shared experiences. Tell me why storytelling is so important to you.
Well, storytelling certainly has made me the father, the husband, the community member, the neighbor with the best gossip, if I could just say, and the human being I am today. And if I could just tell you, I was born in 1971, Tamara, and so I grew up, with The Edge of Night, Canada's first soap opera, and then The Beachcombers, and then Good Rockin' Tonight was Stu Jeffrey, Degrassi Junior High, Aliens, Predator, Star Wars. So I was a great Canadian growing up, born and raised in Fort Smith, Northwest Territories, Treaty 8 country, best childhood, best life, things are going great. And then when I graduated from high school, I just realized that I actually didn't have a life plan at all. I wanted to be a breakdancer. I wanted to be a ninja. I could make, nunchucks out of hockey sticks. That was it. That was my lifeboat. And I also wanted to moonwalk like Michael Jackson. So so everybody else but me had gone to the guidance counselor, and they were going to NAEP and SAIT and U of A and UVic and Grant McEwen and all these great institutions. And I was actually the only 19-year-old in Fort Smith. And I realized that I didn't have a clue or a plan. And then one day on our green screen, the community channel, it said, handy bus drivers needed. If you have a class five driver's license and no criminal record, that was the other thing. They paid extra for the blinking and no criminal record. Come see Cheryl at the Fort Smith Health Center. And so I went, that's what I'm going to do. I delivered papers. I delivered the Edmonton Journal and the Saber Journal growing up, and I pumped gas at Kelly's. So I thought I knew my little community. And I thought, well, why don't I just start it as a volunteer and see where this goes? This feels really good to me because my own grandparents didn't speak any English. They lived many hours up the road in Bechecole, north of Yellowknife. But everybody in Fort Smith could speak Bush Cree and Dene Sutlene because we're officially quadrilingual. We're the Métis capital of the Northwest Territories. So long story short, I show up at the Fort Smith Health Center. Cheryl Common is there. And I said, hello, Mrs. Common. She goes, hello, Richard. I said, I'm here to fill out an application to drive the handy bus. And I said, yeah. And she goes, great, you're hired. So bingo tonight at 8 o'clock. Get ready. I'm going to give everyone your dad's number, 2823, and get ready. You're going to be really busy. So that's really that was my initiation to something bigger and something far more beautiful than I ever realized. So I got to drive Amelia Gatrix, Maria Brown, Seraphine Evans, John Evans, just Maria Brown, our matriarchs and our light bringers and the bosses of our community. I got to drive them to bingo and physio and to the landslide to see the pelicans returning to the Slave River. And I did that for many months. And then one day, Maria Brown, I'm driving her. She was a Chipewyan elder. And she goes, did I ever tell you about the time I died? And I said, what? Right? And she goes, did I ever tell you about when I saw heaven? And I said, no. And so she goes, oh, heaven's like West Edmonton Mall. Everybody's 24 and there are floors and everyone's visiting. And I wanted to stay. I saw my late parents and I saw my late husband. But a voice said, Maria, you can't stay. You still have work. And I didn't want to stay, she said. And she says, I woke up and I was in my sewing room and I had just had a little nap because I was just feeling so tired. And it took me a long time to move again because I must have passed for 20 minutes, half an hour. So yeah, I've seen heaven. And the message, Richard, is that we're all here to work and you're doing very good work, my boy. And that was when I realized a couple of things. A, Heaven's Like West Edmonton Mall. Hello. And number two, no one was recording our stories. So I went to the Radio Shack in Fort Smith and I bought the micro cassette recorder with those little square. You remember those, right?
Yeah.
And I bought it for $21. And then I went back the next day. And you can actually listen, if you go Richard Van Camp SoundCloud, we digitized the tape. You can actually hear Maria Brown the second day when I went back to get her. I said, Maria, can you please tell me? I said, I think there's a lot of people who need to know what's waiting on the other side. And it's so beautiful what she shared with me. So I recorded Maria Brown and then Seraphine Evans and then Amelia Gatrix and then Irene Sanderson. So I had quite a few recordings for my community. And then I went to the Anelkin Center in Penticton, and I'm going to give you an opportunity to ask me a question, but this is really this is really important.
Yeah.
To benefit everybody who's watching us right now. So I went to the Anelkin International School of Writing, I think in 92 for college, and my instructors were Jeanette Armstrong, Lee Miracle, the late Maurice Kenny, and we had an elder in residence named Glenn Douglas. And Glenn was a decorated veteran, one of Canada's most decorated Indigenous soldiers. He was 65 in 1992, and I was during the time of the Oka crisis. So I sat down with Glenn, and we kind of knew each other. And I said, Uncle, I said, I have around 7 or 8 elder stories from my community. They're beautiful miracle stories. I have permission to share them. I've written them out, transcribed them word for word, and I've photocopied their portraits. I said, we're going through a really dark time here in Canada with the Oak crisis. I said, is there a story that you would consider sharing? I said, I can pay you. I've got a little bit of money here. I've got some tobacco. I've photocopied the stories I have. I don't really know why I'm doing this. It feels good to record elders sharing beautiful stories and messages for the youth. And he looked at me, he said, you got that little recorder that you're always carrying around? I said, yeah. He says, how many tapes do you have? I said, oh, I've got a bunch of extra tapes that were blank. And he goes, how many batteries? I said, I got lots of batteries. I'm a Virgo. He says, great, I'll tell you a story. So you can listen to what he told me, Tamara. So you go to Richard Van Camp SoundCloud. Glenn Douglas, I didn't know this at the time, had survived World War II as a soldier, had survived the Korean War as a soldier, and had survived Vietnam as a soldier. Decorated. And he shared with me a story about getting hit with a concussion grenade in the Korean War. It killed him. He saw the other side as a soldier. He describes it, and it's magnificent. I'm not going to paraphrase it because you can actually listen to his voice because we digitized the little tape. He said the same thing. It was so beautiful. And the same voice had the same message, and it was, Glenn, you can't stay. You're going to be told many times you will never walk again. You will walk again. Have faith. And he didn't want to leave because he had so much guilt as a soldier and as a human being for everything he saw. I'm certain there had been many firefights he'd been involved in. And when he woke up, he was actually in his own body bag. And they were just getting ready to sew him up. And it was a helicopter pilot who saw him in his body bag and opened his eyes. And he said, that soldier's not dead. So Glenn shared that, I think it was April 29th, 1992, when he was 65, I believe. I could be getting mixed up. But it was 1992, and he was certainly 65 years old. And he shared this beautiful story, which you can listen to completely. So I had these two stories of heaven, visits to heaven, from two elders from different parts of Canada, different nations, telling the same story that we're here to work and we're called home when our work is done. And then from there, I just kept interviewing and interviewing more elders and more knowledge keepers and more storytellers about their miracles. And that's really what Gather is about. Is my wish is that, and our wish with the publisher, University of Regina Press, is that it restores your faith in life and the bigger plan. You know, the Lakota have a saying, may each day put a sunrise in your heart. And really, that's what we want with hope. I think right now we're all struggling, right? We've been bearing the weight of this global pandemic. It's been so hard, especially as parents. You and I are parents. So you wonder, well, what kind of world have we brought our kids into if they can't even play? They can't do their sports. They can't go to school the way they used to. You know, when my son leaves now, he masks up, right? We're doing laundry every night and it's our masks, right? Every night. So shoes, masks, hat, right? But Yeah. Luckily, I think the storytellers, great storytellers, remind you that all storms pass. And we've been here before. You think about TB, influenza, polio, Spanish flu. We have been here before as a species, and we're going to beat this. We're going to come through this and hopefully come through this with different priorities. So a question, what are you going to do differently once you have bow shots and everybody you know and love has bow shots and hopefully they get to work on kids' vaccinations? What are you, what was the gift of this pandemic?
Are you asking me?
Yeah.
Who's doing this interview, Richard?
Well, I want to know. We're visiting.
Yes, I know. You know what? It's a really good question. I mean, I miss my friends. I miss my, you know, core group of friends. I miss my family. I want to gather is what I want to do, right? And I think that that's what our kids miss too, is that gathering of, I was looking through photos, Richard, the other day. I thought, oh, you know, in this extra time that I have, I'll organize all my photos in my, you know, iPhoto. There's lots of them. And as I went through them, they made me happy, but they also made me feel really sad when I saw all the people in there. Whereas the last, you know, 14, 15, 16 months are just us in our house, really, which is not a bad thing, but it doesn't feed me like it does when I'm around my community. Do you know what I mean?
I do. You've got to fill your own love cup in different ways.
I was going to ask you, Richard, you know, one of the things I noticed, and you made me think of this when you were telling that story about the elders and their stories, is when I tell my kids stories of when they were born, like the day they were born and what it was like and how I was feeling, and or if I tell them about something when I was a child or something, their faces light up so much. They love those stories that they don't know about. Is that where it starts for our own children? Does it start through the stories that we share?
Absolutely. I think you're talking about inheritance. Mm. Inheritance. And, you know, we're so blessed now with all this time with our children and our spouses. I think, you know, for me, I think it's ridiculous. I was hopping on a plane twice or sometimes three times a month to tour. When you have 26 books out in 26 years, there's an expectation, promote, right? And I can't imagine what that did for my wife, Kiwi, or our little boy at Zazie, who was 4 and 5 when I was touring like a maniac. And the good news now is that we have Zoom. We never need to do that again. So I think the one thing we all realize as we get older as parents is that we don't need more stuff. We need more stories, more names, more recipes. I mean, what a treasure it is to dig up one of your grandparents or your favorite aunt's recipe for a specific family celebration, or for kids to know the story of how you met, right? Mm. Why they have the name that they do, where their little belly button nub is. Tamara, where is your baby's belly button nub? Do you remember?
I don't think I kept it.
So at Zazie, we had a home birth. Yeah. So he was born across the hallway. We had midwives and a doula and a water birth. And he was handed to me in water. And I was the first person to hold him after mommy carried him for 9 months. And then on day, I think it was day 14, his little belly button up fell off. And yeah, we were told by a Fort Smith elder, the late Dot Desjardins, you know, buried under a tree so that your baby will always know where they're from. So Zazie knows that. So when he's out in the front yard, he knows his little belly button nub was buried there under a full moon after a feast with all his aunties and uncles and his godparents. We all sprinkled tobacco on the little medicine pouch it was buried in. So that's the inheritance that we're all craving, that this is why I was named. And that's why, you know, and I embrace the technology for me to digitize these little microcassettes and for people to hear themselves telling stories now that they're great grandparents or grandparents. So another thing, as I have a YouTube channel, I found the footage of my grandmother, Melanie Washi, singing a Klecho Dene love song at a talent show. And maybe we could put that in the link. We'll work it out. But I looked for years to find this footage. I called CKLB and CJCD and CBC North. And I would say, everyone keeps saying my grandmother, my Etsy, stood up one night and stole the show, cracked jokes, sang the most beautiful love song, and nobody knew what I was talking about. And then an elder would come up and say, did you ever find the footage of your grandmother singing those love songs? Oh, it was so... So then I would start again. Anyways, as luck would have it, we have an elder here named Frankie Black who lives in Edmonton. He lives just right down the street. And every time he comes by, I give him elk meat and moose meat and buffalo meat as just as a gift because he's an elder. I also get a lot of books from the Northwest Territories. So I always give. Like you, I'm a giver. And then one night he showed up at our door with a stack of DVDs of old drum dances. And wouldn't you know, Tamara, on that DVD was the footage of my grandmother singing a love song. So if you go Richard Van Camp YouTube, you'll see it comes up first. You'll see my grandmother. I looked for 9 years for that footage. So now that we have it, my mom has it because my grandmother, our grandmother passed, must be 18 years ago, but we have that forever because if I ever want to learn a love song, we have that now. If any of my brothers want to learn a love song, if my niece wants to learn a love song, we have that forever. And I think that's the gift of this pandemic is to finally go through your stuff and say, well, why don't I digitize this cassette or this cassette, or why don't I take that old movie of grandpa telling a story about how he met grandma and let's get it out there and share it because that's what's going to nail people to their seats and go, oh my God, thank you for finding that. So, you know, I always say if I could find pictures of you at your baptism, or if I could find pictures of your parents' wedding in the diocese or in the archives, and I could digitize them and send them to you, wouldn't that be the most exciting gift? Or if I said, hey, somebody has been on ancestry.com and they've been able to link your family with theirs, can I send you the link? Oh, by the way, they have photos and recipes and this and that and the other. That's inheritance. And that's what we're all craving because inheritance is about initiation and feeling like this is who I am. These are my people. This is where I belong. And this is proof it's a reminder that we're all miracles. We're all needed. And life is incredible. When you think about it, I don't know if you know this, but my little boy came to me in a dream before he was born. I met my boy in a dream. And did the same thing happen to you, Tamara? Did you ever have that happen?
I think probably, yeah. I think. I know I've had many dreams where, you know, my grandfather passed away when I was 21. And I know my grandpa has, I know I've woken up and been, you know, with my grandpa. I know that.
He's checking up on you.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes, Richard, when I say that sort of stuff to my friends, they think that, you know, I'm a little bit bananas for saying that because people don't believe it, right? They don't think it's true. But I do think it does happen.
I know it happens. I've got a dime over there that my late friend Trevor Evans left for me. I was really missing him one day. And we were just at King Edward Park and I just put my little boy's backpack down. And I'd gone and I forgot the hand sanitizer. Remember March and April last year when everything was about the hand? So I go, oh, I forgot the hand sanitizer. And I go back and I was really missing my buddy Trev, just missing him. And there was a dime. Actually, it's right here. I get it for you. Oh, no, it's gone now. He doesn't want you to see it. No, it was, wait, no.
What's the significance of the dime?
Well, I'm told that anytime a little dime is left behind, it's just somebody from the other side letting you know that they know you missed them.
I've heard this too.
Yeah. Yeah. Isn't and that was that... the dime. I took a picture. I sent it to his mom, to his father.
Wow.
To, you know, to the mom of his beautiful children and to, and she made, she showed the kids and.
That's amazing.
I think when we share miracle stories about, you know, visits from the other side, or when you're in the presence of the sacred, it reminds people that there's something a lot bigger happening all the time. And our job, of course, like what Maria said and what Glenn said, we're here to work, we're here to serve. And as you get older, so when, you know, in the Western culture, our model, I think the pandemic really showed us that the Western model has failed us all because we move so far away from our family and our people and our nation and our support group. And then when something like this happens, you don't have the aunties, the uncles, the cousins, the grandparents to help you so that everyone's battling over who gets to watch the kids next, right? And that's really to our detriment. That really truly is to our detriment for all the right reasons, right? So
yeah, when families spread out and then the stories bring us together. And I want to ask you about, your new book and about being an author and a storyteller. But before I do that, you know, as a way to thank our guests for their time for being here, we give back. And we want to give United Way Northwest Territories $500 on your behalf. That is the charity that you chose. Why did you choose the United Way Northwest Territories?
Well, first of all, Mussy Cho to the United Way. We're so grateful because, as you know, with climate change, there were huge floods in Fort Simpson and Jean Marie River. So there have been over 700 what I'm calling climate refugees because of this flooding. So we have many people being hosted in Fort Smith, Yellowknife, you know, a few people in Yellowknife and Hay River as well. So I just happened to Google when, and I thank you for that generous offer, when you said we're going to be making a donation, it had to be something that had a great partnership already with the Northwest Territories. And I know that the United Way does a lot of good work in Fort Simpson. So I can't imagine what 700 people are going through right now to not know if what it's going to be like to go back and your basement is, I mean, we've had a flood here in Edmonton. Everybody on our street flooded years ago. It was what they call the 100-year rainstorm. I'll never forget it. Now, we were home. We caught it in time. I think damage was only $9,000 and insurance covered most of that. So I mean, it was a tiny flood. I can't imagine what it's like to be in Fort Smith right now in somebody's home who's generously and literally not know if you still have a home to go back to. Because, of course, once the mold and the spores and everything else, once it's sorted out, right, it's terrible. It's terrifying. So I really wanted to do something that would directly benefit, because you can bet United Way will be involved in the reclamation and the rebuilding, because they are going to have to rebuild. Mm-hmm. An entire community is going to have to rebuild.
Yeah. Well, yeah, listen, we will be giving them $500 on your behalf for you spending some time with us here.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mara. Thank you. Thank you for that. Now, listen, is there a difference between being a good author and being a good storyteller?
Yes. So I just told this in an evening class Zoom, but it's funny and it's as real as it gets. So when you are a writer, you can borrow and not have to face a whole lot of consequences. And I can prove it. So my buddy Junior Mercury, who lives in Spruce Grove over there, got us tickets to Nickelback. And so here in Edmonton. So I love the song Never Again. I think it's just fantastic. I love the video. I love it. And so we go to, I think it was Rexall Place, and I'm an exaggerator. I think there were 46,000. They're probably 27,000, but in my mind, it's 46,000. And we're standing in the nosebleeds. There's a reason nobody wanted these tickets. So my hair, my fabulous hair, is brushing against the powder on the concrete ceiling. And everybody in front of us was standing. And Chad says, it's going to be 3 hours. I'm going to sing my lungs out. This is the last night of our North American tour. We love you, Edmonton. So get ready. And I was like, so excuse me. Chad said that he's going to, so we can sit for 3 hours. We can sit because I paid good money to be here. And I certainly didn't. That's so Fort Smith. You know what I mean? Exaggerate, deny, till you die. Anyway, so I make a case. I get mad, right? I'm like, we're going to stand. We're standing. What? And this gentleman to my left, big guy, coveralls, big work boots. And I say to him, I say, can you believe this? Buddy, can you believe this? We're going to have to stand for 3 hours. And he goes, are you serious? They're not going to sit down? I said, no, they're not going to stand. That means we got to stand. And he goes like this. And he goes, well, this is going to be about as much fun as a gut full of pinworms. And he stands up, and we stood for 3 hours, and I couldn't tell you what Chad and the boys sang, because I was like, that's the greatest line in the world. This is going to be about as much fun as a gut full of, and that's really how I started Godless But Loyal to Heaven, the second story of Torchy in my collection, Godless But Loyal. That was the million-dollar line. So I don't know this gentleman. Bless his heart. Many more acres in heaven for you, sir. we don't know each other. We didn't exchange business cards. It wasn't appropriate at the time, right? Yeah. Everybody was hotboxing, okay? Anyway, so I'm a victim of the THC, can I just say? So anyway, so that's as an author, I don't know him. Chances are he will not read my literature. I don't know, right?
Right.
That's the $1 million line. When somebody shares a story with you, so let's say Glenn Douglas or any of the storytellers that you see here, there was a contract for permission. There was money was exchanged, but it's more than a contract of money. For the rest of my life, I am indebted to each of the storytellers, whether it's Rosa Mantla or Barry Clark or Pauline Clark, everyone for life, I owe them. Whether it's meat, whether it's gifts, whether it's more copies of the book, I am indebted in a beautiful way because they welcomed me and they trusted me into the miracles of their lives. So that's the difference between being a writer and a storyteller. In my opinion.
That's amazing. I love it. Plus, you and I would get along well at a concert. I don't like it when I have to stand up for 3 hours either.
Yes, yeah.
Tell me, how can someone be a storyteller? If someone's listening right now and they think, I don't know how to tell a story. I don't know how to tell stories. I could, you know, maybe tell a story, but I'm not a storyteller. I don't want to tell a story. Can we all be storytellers or is it something?
Yes, I think I know you can. So the other day, the gift of this pandemic, of course, is that we have more time together. So just the other day, our cohort family, Sally, her boys were playing with my boy. Everyone's got masks. So the parents are standing very far apart. And then Greg, who started Oho Coffee in Edmonton, he's there. We spoke for 40 minutes, laughing, talking, sharing stories. And I said, you know what? This wouldn't have happened a year ago. I said, Greg, you were running down the alley at 7 o'clock every morning to catch your bus with your coffee. I said, Sally, you were at your desk from, was it 8 to 6? Because she had clients in Ontario who started 2 hours before Edmonton. And she had clients in Vancouver who were still on an hour after everybody logged off here in Alberta. Anyways, I said, the gift now of this pandemic is the time, but also the risk. We're risking our truths and letting each other in. So if you want to be a great storyteller, it's a muscle. You've got to start somewhere. It's a craft. And the more you invest in your craft. So what you can do is watch a lot of stand-up. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
Yeah, watch Bruce and Dane Cook or whoever it is that just makes you howl. Get the persona. Become the story. And really, the story is the boss. So don't be afraid to do, my wife says she doesn't do impersonations. She does the great, that's one of the many reasons I fell in love with Kiwi Martin is her impersonations. Because when she's in it, she's in it. And I love it. I live for it. I beg her to impersonate, you know, fill in the blank. She's got about 27 different, you know, impersonations down. So have fun with it. You're not going to break anything, right?
Right.
So I think when you are, you know, when the parents are standing around and the kids and everyone's socially distanced, never be afraid to say, hey, do you guys know that, you know, and see where it goes. Risk your truth. Yeah. Risk something fun. And chances are everybody's bored out of their trees and are willing to risk something right back. So have fun with it. And again, just go forth in a good way and
yeah,
you know, share a miracle story. And also, like, if you've ever if you've ever saved somebody's life, or if you have ever had your life saved,
that's a good story.
That's usually my prompt. Is like, hey, did you guys know that I just about died when my appendix blew when I was 7? It was actually the Calgary Children's Hospital that saved my life. That's usually when people go, are you serious? Oh my God, what happened? And then that's the hook. You got them. And then chances are everyone's got a, oh my God, I just about died too story. You know what I mean?
Yes. Yeah, totally. Tell me who, when you were growing up, who was your favorite storyteller when you were in your family, in your community, when you were growing up?
I think the aha moment for me as a storyteller is there was this beautiful Chipewyan bush cook named David King. My dad would always hire him out at Sioux Lake because my dad taught for Arctic College. He taught a course called Renewable Resources Technology Program. So they would take students for 6 months. Your first day, you're on a bush plane. You're out in the bush on Sioux Lake, hours out of the community, for 5 weeks. And it was a portage. You learned gun safety, boat safety, plant safety. You were in the classroom on the land. It's a celebrated program. And my dad would always hire David King because David could cook for 20 or 200 at the drop of a hat. He put bear grease in everything. His pie crust, his bannock, his pickerel fish fries were legendary. He loved my little brother, Raj. He loved my little, but he could never remember Roger's name. He kept calling him Rodney. He'd say, "Where's Rod? I need my little Rodney. Rodney, you sit here. Rodney, how do you like your bannock?" Anyway, so I'll get to the gist. So one day we had a cinnamon bear that had wandered into Fort Smith, and every time I would hop on my bike to go and see it, it would take off. And everybody and their monkey saw the cinnamon bear except me. And I was pretty sour grapes about it. And when David would come over to see my mom and dad, he would kick my mom and dad out of the kitchen. He would grab little Rodney, put him on the counter, and then I would get scraps, right? Story of my life, right? And I was saying, "Raj, I think it's pretty cheap." In Smith, we say bone. "I think it's pretty bone that I haven't seen the cinnamon bear out by the Caribou Trailer Court." And Raj is, you know, having some fresh gourmet David King bannock. And he goes, "You didn't see the cinnamon? Everybody's seen the cinnamon bear." And I said, "Yeah, you know, I get on my BMX, I can't see it." And so David realized something was happening and he was cooking away and he said, "Nephew, what are you saying?" And I said, "Oh, sorry, uncle." I said, "It's just that I want to see the cinnamon bear that is coming, you know, into our community by the Caribou Trailer Court." And he goes, "Oh, I saw it. I saw it yesterday." And I go, "Exactly. Well, I haven't seen it." And he said, "You know, nephew, you have to be very careful around bears." And I said, "Oh, why?" And he said, "Because a bear always knows what you're thinking. Every animal has medicine power. Every person is born with medicine power. Your job in this life is to figure out what your medicine power is. You develop it and you share it with the world. That's why we're here, nephew." And I never forgot that. And that was really the day I felt like as a storyteller, I was given my wings, because I knew, Tamara, that what I wanted to learn as a human being this time around on this gorgeous planet, what I wanted to learn would not be in any textbook, would not be in any novel, would not be in any comic book. It had to be from the elders. It had to be from the knowledge. What I wanted was not written down. And so that's why I've spent my entire career reclaiming and recording those elders who really know their stuff. Because once you have it forever for future generations. So it was David King who gave me my wings as a storyteller. And it was Lee Miracle in 91 at the Inaukun Center in 92 who said, "The beauty of fiction is you can find what has been stolen from your life in your writing. You can fix what has been broken in your life with your writing, and you can resurrect the dead in your writing." That was when I felt like I developed my second set of wings as a writer. So I'm really grateful to Lee Miracle and to David King, because they really set me free in a way to go forth and continue to be upset with the curriculum, because I just remember being so bored K through 12 going, I don't need this. What I need is out there in the bush and with the trappers and the hunters and the fishermen and the elders. And so that gather is really my dream come true of finally making good on that disgruntled little boy who just knew something was inherently wrong with the curriculum. And, you know, I will say right now in the North, we have the Dene Cadet curriculum, which is curriculum by Northerners for Northerners. So they're with the beautiful, everything that's coming out with Indigenous literature, I feel like every family now has something that they can take from a local author, local storyteller, to help them realize this is the land that you're on. These are the stories that are yours to listen to and respect. These are the laws of this territory here, and they're laws for a reason. So why not embrace them? And I just want to add to what I was talking about early. So the first part of your life in Western culture is, I'm going to build, I'm going to craft, I'm going to sculpt, I'm going to dig, I'm going to make a name for myself. you get to 49, I'm 49 now, and you start to realize I have too much.
Mm-hmm.
I have too much. I gotta give back, because yeah. The best part as you get older is you start to realize, how do I want to be remembered?
Yes.
I'm not here to take, I'm not here to steal, I'm not here to, you know. And it was Bernie Bergman, also a great, great wildlife officer, family friend. He was the one who said, Richard, a true northerner always leaves each person and each place better than they found them.
That's beautiful.
That mm-hmm. really, I think that's what it means to be a decent human being.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I love this book, Richard. It is, I love you. I mean, I feel like I've known you for an entire life, you know, I really do. And your energy and your ability to tell a story is pretty special. And I mean, 26 books in 26 years. What did you say? That's a page a day.
Page a day is a book a year. Carolyn Swayze.
Page a day is a book a year. Page a day is a book a year.
That's Stephen King right there. Page a day is a book a year.
I love his book on writing. Isn't it good?
Incredible. It was, so it was everybody's Bible in 90.
Yes.
It was New Vic in 93. And everybody had. Then it became Eat, Pray, Love. Then it became Eat,
yes,
Pray, Love.
Yes, exactly. Yeah,
then it became 50 Shades of Grey. Then it became 50 Shades
of Grey. No. Richard, thank you so much for spending some time with us. I really
thank
appreciate
you.
It.
Bless you.
The book is Gather, Richard Van Camp on Storytelling. Is in bookstores now. It's wherever you buy your books. And remember, if you'd like to learn more about Richard and his incredible body of work, you can visit richardvancamp.com and follow him on Twitter at Richard Van Camp. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you, Tamara. It's been a pleasure and a privilege and an honor. Musi Cho. I'm so grateful to you. From my family to yours, Musi Cho. Take care.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.